be afraid. Real simple song. I want to teach it to you tonight. The Lord is my light and salvation. Whom shall I fear? Whom shall I be afraid? The Lord is my light and salvation. Whom shall I fear? Yeah. Whom shall I be afraid? I will wait on you. I will wait on you. You, yes. I will trust in you. Yes, Lord. Say, I will trust in you. Y'all help me. The Lord is my light. Everybody sing. The Lord is my light and salvation. Whom shall I fear? You say it. Whom shall I be afraid? No, no. The Lord is my light and salvation. Whom shall I fear? No, no. Whom shall I be afraid? I will wait on you. Raise your voice. Hey, I will wait on you. Trust in you. The next part goes like this. Listen, I want you to go home singing this. I will remain confident in this. I will see the goodness of the Lord. Come on, you say it. I will remain confident in this. I will see the goodness of the Lord. Now, if you believe that, raise your voice and give him praise in here tonight.
Oh, my friends, this is the day the Lord has made. We should rejoice and be glad in it. Greetings to the entire St. Paul's Everywhere family. We want to say Happy New Year to everybody, and we want to welcome all of you again to The Bridge. We hope that you'll take a moment to download our student outline. There are links in the chat space. I hope that you are ready for a fresh start as you begin this new year. Last week, we talked about making a fresh start in your faith. Today, we're going to focus on making a fresh start in your finances. Yeah, your finances, like this, it's like that. You know the song, In Your Finances. That's what we're gonna talk about today. Your money, making a fresh start in your finances. Yes. If you were going to teach this lesson instead of me, where would you start on your research? Here's where a lot of us start. I Googled the words fresh start and finances. I was somewhat shocked at what came through me or at me through the screen, because I knew that there would be a whole lot on bankruptcy, because that's the world we live in. I didn't know it would virtually be all on bankruptcy. And I guess for some of you, that may not be a surprise. If you bought a house in 2006, you might need a fresh start in your finances. Or maybe in 2008, you went through a difficult divorce, you might need a fresh start in your finances. Or in 2010, your business went belly up, or in 2012, you saw a doctor and he said, you got this or that disease, or a family member has this or that condition, and your insurance refused to cover it. You may need a fresh start in your finances. Or in 2020, when COVID hit, it hit not only your job, your family, your schedule, but your finances. You might need a fresh start. This is not a surprising topic for any of us, especially if you have kids in college or you're in college yourself. That's probably one of the most difficult financial stressors of all, because that means that for the next 4, 6, 8, 10, 15 years, you could be paying $25,000 to $50,000 every single year. But don't worry if you're a parent, because you're going to recover a little bit of that money when they move back home and you make them pay rent. Okay, just a little humor there on the money side. But how many Virginians went bankrupt last year? It may shock you, 23,000. We are living in a financial crisis, in times of financial crisis. So when I Googled those words, fresh financial start, a book by that title came up, authored by Sherry Olafson. She takes the thousands upon thousands of pages of governmental regulations and she distills them into a book that's about 290 pages. I got through the first 100 pages and honestly, I got a little bored. But what's interesting is this: the world's answer to a financial fresh start was to go to a professional who will help you to get out from under that oppressive debt for a little fee. That was the best solution that we could find from the culture. And I began to think, does the word of God, does the church have anything better to say than bankruptcy or assistance for a fee? I think that we do. Now, if you're a Christian and you have experienced bankruptcy, let me add a quick footnote so you don't go down the wrong track, but just tell you that God already planned for that. God already planned for our financial mishaps. For real, it's in the Bible. In the Old Testament, among the Hebrews, God provided, because God already planned that every 7 years, all debts would be eliminated. Wouldn't that be amazing? Because God knows that some of us, no, I should say most of us, often because of foolish decisions that are our fault, or catastrophes imposed upon us, or a disease that comes suddenly into our lives, we get turned upside down financially. And God's desire is that our financial crisis not be passed on to the next generation, nor serve as a source of oppression for us in the days that we live. So if you're streaming today and you're thinking, Well, preacher, I've been through bankruptcy. I can't be a Christian. That is definitely not what I am saying. I am saying that scripture has a better solution than bankruptcy for you and for me. And there are some guidelines for establishing our finances and building wealth that I believe if we follow will make it significantly less likely that we will find ourselves in a position where we have to go through bankruptcy. And some of them are as easy as ABC. Can I start with the A? It's on your outline. Follow me here and write this down. The A stands for anticipation. Will you say it out loud with me? Anticipation. Well, a lot of people may call this delayed gratification. It is when you have the ability to simply wait to buy that thing that you cannot now afford. Walter Mischel was a psychologist in the 1960s. He did a social science experiment that I think that to this day is one of the most important social science experiments ever done. And he did it with four-year-olds and marshmallows. What he did was take a string of four-year-olds and a string of marshmallows and put them together. He laid the string of marshmallows on the table in front of the string of four-year-olds assembled, and he said to them, look, you can either eat the marshmallow that's in front of you right now, it's yours, you can eat it if you want to, or if you wait, when I come back, I will add a second marshmallow to your string and you can have two marshmallows. All you have to do is wait. That experiment has been replicated dozens of times with the identical results. Do you want to guess what happened? Some ate it, some didn't. But here's the big issue that he discovered. Walter Mischel came back 15 years after that initial experiment and investigated those same children and found that virtually 100% of the children that waited had graduated from high school with an almost 0% dropout rate. Their SAT and ACT scores were on the average 210 points higher than their peers. All of them had either gotten a job or gotten into college or gone into the military. And get this, even their body mass index was lower than that of their peers. This experiment, I think, is important because it's like the secret sauce to success, not just financially, but in life in general, that our ability to wait to eat a marshmallow or our insistence on eating the marshmallow now has significant consequences. And for those of you who just can't wait, you know it because you're a part of the swipe it and get it posse. I promise you, if you are not very careful and you're a part of that crew, I got to get mine now, you're going to end up in unmanageable debt. That's just the way that the credit system is designed to work. And in fact, it's difficult for us to avoid credit card debt when we walk around with credit cards in our pockets all the time. Think about it for a moment. Just be reasonable. Companies don't offer you credit cards because they are interested in your long-term financial well-being. You know that intuitively, right? Companies are in the credit card business to make money, specifically your money. Listen to what I'm about to say. We always pay. Everybody say always. Now type it in the chat space, always. The only issue is you pay now or you pay later with interest, but you always pay. Let me read very quickly while I have your attention, two passages of scripture that illustrate this point. And the point I'm making is that debt is bondage. Debt slows everything down. And if we can't wait to buy what we can't afford, we will end up in debt. Proverbs 22:7. The wise King Solomon had this to say about debt and bondage. The rich rule over the poor, and the borrower is the servant to the lender. Let that sink in. If you don't like the Old Testament, go to the New Testament. The Apostle Paul expressed the same principle using different words. Romans 13:7. He says, give to everyone what you owe them. If you owe taxes, pay taxes. If you owe revenue, pay revenue. If you owe respect, pay respect. If you owe honor, pay honor. I think it's interesting to read that talk about taxes and revenue and what we owe as we stand right here today between our Christmas bills and our upcoming tax bills. It's a difficult time for us to think about finances, but we must. It's the right time, because if you always do what you always did, you will always get what you've always gotten. That's the wisdom of Moms Mabley. Paul continues in Romans 13 with this verse: let no debt remain outstanding except the continuing debt to love one another. For whoever loves his fellow man and fellow woman has fulfilled the law. God is calling you, if you are watching this stream today, to be a debt-free person. Can you imagine it? Debt-free. Just type in the chat space, debt free. Now that raises the question, how do we escape the bondage of debt? I'm glad you asked. Here's rule number two. Remember, rule number one had to do with anticipation. Here's rule number two. It's the B in the ABC equation. Buy for function and not for reputation. Harvey Mackey has a book called How to Swim with the Sharks. It's a great business book. It's not an economic book or financial book necessarily, but Mackey tells a principle in that book that is strikingly simple and profitable for all of us. He said that when he first got into business, all he could afford to drive was a Kia, K-E-I. Some of you remember that. It was a Japanese car. That dates him, for those of you who really know what a Kia was. It was basically a car box. Its only function was to get you from point A to point B. No frills, no thrills, no perks, just basic transportation. But then Mackey concluded in the book, that is the point of a car, right? The point of a car is to get you from point A to point B. My version of that was a Chevette. Basic, stripped down. And a car is one of those unique items that the minute you buy it, listen, it begins to depreciate until the moment you sell it, kill it, or bury it. Real estate, on the other hand, historically gains in value from the minute you buy it until the moment that you sell it. So Mackey, throughout his career, when he made millions upon millions of dollars, never surrendered his Kia. He never upgraded. He stuck with the idea of basic transportation. He kept buying these gutless little box cars that would get you from point A to point B, which is the point of a car. It is the point of transportation, because he didn't care, here it is, about the reputation of the car. He only wanted the function of the car. Now, contrast that with real estate, with his houses. He kept getting bigger and bigger houses until they were literally multi-million dollar houses, because he understood that was a better investment for him. And I can illustrate this with cars and clothes. Here's what happens. Let's pretend you work in a business office and everybody needs a watch. Okay, pretend that you don't have a cell phone, but everybody needs a watch to get to your meetings on time. So we all go out to Target and we get these $10 watches, and they work just fine, because the purpose of a watch is not style, although we often buy them for that. Purpose of a watch is to know what time it is. But some pompous knucklehead in your office decides they want to be better than everybody else. So he goes out and buys a $300 watch. No, let's not be that extravagant. A $100 watch, so he can come in and show off how wealthy he is, even though he's exactly $90 less wealthy than the rest of us who got the watch from Target. But what happens? The others look around because he's got a nice watch on, and they conclude, I better get a watch that matches his so that I can floss and bling like he's flossing and blinging. And pretty soon, all the employees in your office have spent now $100 on a watch, which now reduces the value of the $100 watch back down to the $10 watch because everybody has it. We all have one. So now the first guy goes out and spends $1,000 on a watch. Do you see what this is? This is an arms race that nobody wins because it keeps reducing to a zero-sum game. Think about all the things that we purchase to impress people that we don't even like. One of my favorite sayings is, stop buying things that you can't fit, don't need, can't afford, and won't wear to impress people that you don't like and folk who really don't care. So how do we get out of the arms race? The answer is rule number three. Remember what I'm about to say. Cash is king. If you own a credit card, you have a credit card, you swipe the credit card. Did you know that there's actually a chemical, oxytocin? Yeah, I think I said it right. Oxytocin. There's an oxytocin rush that people get from swiping their credit card. It feels good, especially ladies, if the shoes are the right shoes. Can I have an amen right there? So you swipe your credit card, you feel good about it, you get the oxytocin rush. Whereas if you do this, if you pull out your purse and pull out your wallet and pull out some cash money, that actually feels painful. And it's been proven that those who statistically spend cash for their purchases will spend 13% less than those who swipe the credit card because spending cash hurts more and you don't get the same kind of chemical rush. Now, being the clever chap that I am, I initially arranged with my bank that they would reduce my credit card bills to zero every month. I haven't paid a penny of interest on a credit card in years because I'm smart, right? Nope, that's what I thought at first, but actually, no. I learned something years ago that I'm still a little salty about, if I'm honest. If you have a points card, which is what I had, you swipe it, you charge the purchase, and you get a whopping 1-2% cash back. The problem is those who use cashback cards, you use it because in your mind, hey, I'm getting money back. I'm saving money, right? Mm-mm. People who use the cashback cards, this is statistically true. Don't take my word for it. Look it up. Spend $110 for every $100 that everybody else spends. So you've got a guy with cash spending $87 and another guy with his credit card paying $100 that ultimately costs him $110, but hey, he's getting a dollar back or $2 back, so he's really only spending $109 or $108. You go broke trying to save money like that. It's the mess that we have been lured into. And the problem is, because of our debt, we're not able to live freely. We're not able to be generous with God. We're not able to be generous with others. Because if you have $15,000 in credit card debt, and that's about the average in our country, or some other upside down type of loan on your car, or maybe your business is struggling and you feel like you need help, let me give you some very quickly. Here it is, two words. This is what I want you to remember. Press pause. Say that out loud with me. Press pause. Now, for the benefit of your neighbors who are streaming, somebody type it in the chat space, press pause. According to bankrate.com, the top 2022 financial goals for United States adults are paying down debt, building an emergency fund, budgeting better. I'm sorry, the top five financial goals, budgeting better, boosting your retirement savings, and investing more money. Let me repeat them. It's paying down debt, building an emergency fund, budgeting better, boosting retirement savings, and investing more money. Here's a little advice on how to stick to your goals. Where should I start in creating a plan to pay down my debt? This is not actually mine. It's from a brilliant sister who writes for the Washington Post. Her name is Michelle Singletary. She writes a financial column for the Washington Post. And Michelle happens to be a faithful practicing Christian along with her entire family. She's absolutely brilliant. And this is what she says. Where should you start in terms of developing your financial plan to pay down your debt? Say your debt amount out loud. Did you get it? Say your debt amount out loud. Of course, you have to know what it is in order to be able to say it. One of the first things to do when you're struggling with this particular resolution is to say out loud how much debt you have. Nearly everybody who's listening to me who's in debt is going to bark at this request, because what happens is we don't know how much we owe, or we're embarrassed about what we owe. But listen to what Michelle says. It's not enough to write it down. Saying the number out loud will do something to your psyche. It will leave the impression of urgency about paying down the debt. Next, make sure you are certain of everything you owe. Pull your credit reports and listen to me closely, because right now, because of what's going on in our country, you can pull all three of your credit reports from now through April for free. Did you hear what I said? Nothing beats free. You can pull all three for free from all three of the credit bureaus, Equifax, Experian, and TransUnion. Pull all three of them so you know what they're listing, because they're not 100% accurate, but that information will count against you if you don't correct it. Make sure of everything you owe. Make sure that your credit reports are accurate. And then finally, she said, one of the most effective ways in tackling debt is to list what you owe, starting with the smallest balance. She calls that strategy debt dash, D-E-B-T-D-A-S-H, debt dash. In addition to your regular payment, she suggests take any extra funds you have and apply them to the principal of your smallest debt. And once you've knocked off that debt, take all the money you have and move on to the next one on your list. If two debts are the same amount, the one with the highest interest rate should come first in order to be able to knock off your debt. Ignore that. It's just trying to interrupt me from giving you this blessing, okay? But move on to the next debt. If two debts are the same amount, the one with the highest interest rate should come first. The logical mathematical method might suggest that you go after your debt with the highest interest rate first, but there's more to debt reduction than just logic. You have to factor in human behavior. I found that when people are able to reduce the lists of debts quickly because they are attacking the ones with the lowest balances, they stick to this resolution. They also speed up their debt reduction, and this in turn results in less interest paid overall. It's all about trying to develop momentum when you're using this method. So let me move to the second issue. What's the best way to save for a financial emergency? I should point out that that number on my phone that was ringing was from some kind of solicitor. It was an unidentified number, and I don't tend to answer them anyway. So it's particularly appropriate for this conversation. What's the best way to save for a financial emergency? Well, when you're trying to build an emergency fund, it's best to do this. It's what we suggest to people with their tithe. Set it and forget it. S-E-T, set it and forget it. Set it up so that there's a direct deposit from your paycheck to a bank account where you're building your emergency fund. I suggest that you may even want to set up a different financial institution from the one where you keep your account from which you pay your bills, because the separation usually results in less temptation to transfer funds into your household account or your spending account to make up for overspending. Now, here's the third issue. How do I stick to a spending plan? Well, in response to a column about budgeting, a reader to Michelle's column once wrote, "My financial motto has always been, I save where I can so I can spend where I want." I like that. That's why I'm repeating it in this study. I save where I can so I can spend what I want. I say to my staff about our CFO, who tends to be tight-fisted. And if you have a CFO, you want them to be tight-fisted. You want them to watch the money. And old Bob does a great job at doing that. I say to my staff that Bob pinches on the dimes so that we can properly spend the dollars. I'm all about telling the truth to yourself and telling yourself the truth. Budgeting better as a person, as a family, and controlling your spending starts with being painfully honest with yourself. Yes, you are eating out more than you think. No, sales do not save you money because you're still spending it, even if it's a less amount. So just to get an idea of how much you spend, try tracking your spending for a month. Get yourself a little notebook, whether it's a digital or whether it's hard copy, and capture all the money you have going out. Yes, even where you spent that $20 that you took out of the ATM. So much of our spending, listen to what I'm saying, is unconscious. Where you see waste, redirect that money to other goals, such as building your emergency fund or trying to pay off debt. The most money you will earn this year will come from paying off debts that you owe. Think about it. The banks are paying you a measly 0.5%, if that, on the money you're trying to save. But you are paying the credit companies at least 5, 6, 8, in some cases, 24% interest on the credit that you have. So if you pay that off, you're going to save all that money. Think about it. Here's the next question. How do I save for retirement? And these should come in some kind of order. Pay off debt, build an emergency fund, save for retirement, which means it's pointless to try to save for retirement when you are drowning in debt. That's got to be number one. It's pointless to try to save for retirement when you don't have an emergency fund, because as soon as an emergency comes, you're going to go into your retirement fund. So think about the sequence. The sequence is important. How do you save for retirement? I want to suggest to you that automation and technology will work in your favor. The first of the year is a good time to look at your retirement savings percentage. What percentage of your income do you allocate for investment for retirement in a 401k, 403b, or some similar workplace plan? Press pause. We've got a free class that we offer on financial matters and budgeting called Money Talks. It's coming up soon, so keep your eyes glued to the website so that you can see it. Log on to our St. Paul's Community Foundation so that you can take it. Because we hold high as a value in our faith community that all of our members, as much as possible, would be and live debt-free. Why? So that they might honor God through their giving and be able to bless others through the income that they have available. Have you ever wondered, when you read that promise in Malachi 3:10 about where God says, if you bring the tithe, I'll open up the windows of heaven and bless you with so much blessing, you won't have room to receive. Have you ever wondered what you are supposed to do with the blessing that you don't have room to receive? Here it is. It's going to bless you. You are to bless your neighbors. You are to bless somebody else. It's not just so you can store it and stock it. God wants you to be in an overflow position so that you can bless somebody else. I know that was a bombshell for you. Look, but you cannot believe the dozens of families who have been liberated from debt because of the class that we offer, Money Talks. And we'll do it again this year. If you are a person listening to me right now who does not have a budget or follow a budget, or you have not been focused on how to spend your money, or you're going through financial difficulty, this is an excellent opportunity for you to get more information and begin to put some of these principles to work. Don't worry about the mistakes you made in the past. You can't fix the past, but you can shape the future. I've only given you three. And while there's not 100 principles, there are more than three. And maybe you could get some rules for wealth that would push your family forward and push you forward financially if you attend the class and continue to focus and start with the ones that I have given you. If you do, just remember this: your rules reveal you. Relationships transform you, and as many good rules as we can offer will help you, because the real key to a financial fresh start is getting a new heart. So I want to suggest that what we need today are not just rules for wealth and rules for making a fresh start financially, but we need to put that side by side with the relationships that we have in our lives, because rules reveal you. Relationships transform you. If you have life-giving, life-breathing relationships, then you have something to spend your money on and to save your money for. So let me suggest three for you very quickly. The first relationship I want to suggest that you look at, you think about, you pray about is your family. For at least 30 years, I've been teaching, and First Lady and I have been practicing the 80-10-10 rule. Somebody write it in the chat space, 80-10-10. That's where you give 10% right off the top to God for as an act of worship, as an act of gratitude, to help extend the kingdom of God on earth. You then save 10%. Also known as paying yourself. And then you, here's an intentional word, discipline yourself to live on the 80. It's 80-10-10. I think it's a great rule. Live by it, teach it to your children, teach it to your grandchildren. It will bless your family. The second relationship that is so important to your financial security is your relationship with God. And the scriptures are pretty clear from the Old Testament to the New that we are to tithe 10% as an act of worship, gratitude, and discipline, that we are to give 10% of what we receive to the kingdom of God, the church of God, to support the work of God in the world. Now, what does that mean? Well, giving 10% as my tithe first clarifies my understanding that not 10%, but 100% of what I have comes from God. I need five of you, if you will, and don't mind, to type in the chat space, everything I own belongs to God. That being true, I return 10% as an act of worship and gratitude. I am crystal clear when I do that about where my blessing comes from, about where my hope resides, about what my relationship with God is really all about. I quoted Malachi chapter 3, verse 10. It's the only passage in the Bible that challenges us to test God. And it is God, through the prophet in that verse, challenging us to put God's promise to the test. Here it is. I'll read it in its entirety. You can read it on your own. Malachi 3:10, bring the whole tithe, the entire 10%, into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house. Test me in this, says the Lord Almighty, and see if I won't throw open the floodgates of heaven and pour out so much blessing that you will not have room to receive it. Do you believe that's true? Everything we have is a blessing, right? So if you have a phone, that's a blessing from God. Would you agree? If you have clothes to wear, that's a blessing from God. If you have food on your table and in your refrigerator and in your cabinets, that's a blessing from God. If you have a mortgage, that mortgage is a blessing from God. Are we in agreement on those things? So why would you pay for the blessings of God in your mortgage and phone and clothes and cars and ignore the command of God to pay first a tithe before you repay for the blessings that God has given you? I thought that this was really good. A. Lewis Patterson, God bless his memory, used to always say that the tithe is not a gift. You owe God the tithe, and you don't even have to be happy about paying it. That's what A. Lewis Patterson used to say. He said, because I don't rejoice when I pay my mortgage. I don't say, woo, thank you, I gotta pay my mortgage. A. Lewis Patterson said, no, I pay it because I owe it. He said, I have to be happy in order to give an offering because that's over and above what I owe. I'm trying to make the case today that when you are faithful to God with your finances, brothers and sisters, so much that you can be generous with your neighbors, that's a cause for rejoicing. So your family is the first relationship. Your relationship with God is the second relationship. There's a third relationship to which I want to suggest you attend. And that would be that we love our neighbors as we love ourselves. The principle implied is that we give to our neighbors, not for transformation, not for clarity, not for security, but for happiness. How much should we give? That's a question mark, isn't it? Because we don't know how much we need to give in order to be happy. How happy do you want to be? That should determine how much you want to give to others. The Apostle Paul said in Acts chapter 20, in everything I did, I showed you by this kind of hard work that I was doing that we must help the weak. Remembering the words of Jesus himself, that it is more blessed to give than to receive. Paul believed that was true. He was a Hebrew. Jesus said that he believed it was true, that it was more blessed to give than to receive. He was likewise a Hebrew. I want to introduce you to another modern Jew who happens to be an atheist. His name was Jonathan Haidt. He wrote a book, one of the most interesting books that I've read in some time, called Happiness, Hypothesis, and Haidt. And other social scientists have studied what makes people happy. His book, Happiness, Hypothesis, and Haidt, was among them. He said that there are basically three things that determine a person's happiness: our genetics, our circumstances, and our choices. According to his book, 50% of your happiness is genetics. The other 50% is dependent upon your circumstances and your choices. Circumstances account for 10% or less. How do you figure that? Well, social scientists who were a part of this study looked at the lives of people who won the lottery and compared it to the lives of those who got in an accident and became paralyzed. And those who won the lottery, of course, their happiness shot up immediately. And you would expect that those who got in an accident, became paralyzed, their happiness would plummet immediately. But as they tracked those two people groups, 3 months, 6 months, 12 months, 5 years, they found that those who had won the lottery, listen close, went back to their biological level of happiness with a variance of only about 10%. And those who were paralyzed went back to their level of happiness with a variance of about 10%. That means, following that study, if there's any truth to it, that our level of happiness is dependent much more on the choices we make, that the choices we make will determine about 40% of our level of happiness. They did this study in Hungary and discovered that the number one thing that brought people happiness was eating dinner with a group of family and friends that they love. It not only brought them happiness, but it saved them money. And if you think about it and you have those circumstances in your life, you know it's true. And yet we keep plowing through the fast food lines and avoiding having dinner with one another. Secondly, here's the second one. They discovered that in terms of our circumstances and our choices, when you get in the zone and get lost in work you love, that you are actually among your happiest times. And when you think about it, you recognize that's true too, because if you have the blessing of doing work that you love and work that you are passionate about, it's easy to get in the zone. Think Michael Jordan, LeBron James, get in the zone when you are doing it. And as you do, you actually make more money because you become better at what you do. So here's the third one that they discovered from that study. When you give your money away to people who cannot pay you back, when you give your time away to people who need it and cannot give you their time back, that is a moment where you are, that is among your most happiest moments. Jesus has been proven by modern social science. When we give ourselves away, when we give our resources away, it is more blessed to give than to receive. Let me try to explain this point and kind of put an exclamation point on it in an old-fashioned way. It's in Matthew chapter 6, verses 19 through 21. These are the words of Jesus, and listen to what he said. Do not store up for yourselves treasures on the earth, where moths and rust destroy and thieves break in and steal, but store up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where moth and rust cannot destroy and where thieves cannot break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. My grandmother used to sing a song that was a paraphrase of those verses where she said, build your hopes on things eternal and whole to God's unchanging hand. People have often asked me, do you think, Pastor, that Jesus is saying that we can actually get greater rewards in heaven by how we spend our time, our money, our minutes on earth? Do you actually think that there are varying levels of reward in heaven? In a word, yes. You can't take it with you, but apparently you can send it on ahead of you. That's why the old people in the church used to sing about sending up my timber every day. They had some idea of this. So here's the takeaway for the study tonight. This is for your outline, and I want you to do it before you scroll away. Circle one of those relationships listed that you feel like, you know what, in 2022, I need to work on my family. There are some things I need to forgive. There are some people I need to contact. There are some candid and critical conversations I need to have. Or maybe for you, it's your relationship with God. Or maybe for you, it's how you relate to your neighbors, to other people in your church, in your community, on your job. But would you pause right now? Press pause. Remember, that's a big part of this lesson. And circle one of those relationships. Because I'm going to pray for you right now. I'm going to pray with you right now. And I'm going to pray that while I'm offering this prayer, the Holy Spirit would come to your mind. One thing that you could do that would bring you closer to a right relationship with your friends, with your family, with your God, so God can give you this year a financial fresh start. Would you pray with me wherever you are? Pause right now, eyes closed, head bowed, as we pray. Gracious God, these are great and powerful promises. And I pray that everyone hearing my voice would have now a face in mind, or you in their mind, or a neighbor in their mind, and that somehow through the power of your Holy Spirit, they would be moved in this moment to invest in and work on that particular relationship. We can't do it without you, God. So move on us now as we prepare to make this fresh start in our finances. Give us faith, give us courage for the journey. because at the end of this year, we don't want to be the same, but we can't do it without you. So bless my brother, bless my sister in Jesus' name. And everybody who agreed with that prayer said, hallelujah, I agree. Thank you, Jesus. May God bless you, my friend, to make a financial fresh start. This is your moment. So get started now. And don't forget to share this Bible study stream with somebody else. Click on that share arrow or copy the URL in your browser and share it with somebody else. It is more blessed to give than to receive. I'm Dr. Lance Watson. God bless you real good. Until next time, see ya.
I want to teach it to you tonight. The Lord is my light, salvation. Whom shall I fear? Whom shall I be afraid? The Lord is my light, salvation. Whom shall I fear? Yeah. Whom shall I be afraid? I will wait on you.